We are talking about the steam engine. I'm sitting on a decade of discovery, over a decade, and so let's go. What's the difference between an open system and a closed system? The steam locomotives just blew steam into the air. They did not collect it and recycle it back around. And so even the vintage steam engines were also open systems. Open systems suffer because they're energy deficit. The closed loop, we have to capture that steam and condense it back into water so that it can go in a continuous loop. The traditional four components, we'll talk about those, introduce those in a second. And then we're going to get into the fifth component, which changes things. There is good reason to revisit steam. Open systems are energy deficit. And so we want to move over to the closed loop side of things. Four components is still deficit. Nothing too exciting going on there. But the fifth component brings us into abundance. And that's what it's all about. That's what we want to talk about and get into. These are the four components of the closed steam loop. We start with the water pump. Its job is to feed water from the low pressure side into the high pressure side. So now we have high pressure water that goes to the hot exchanger. Here it's going to flash boil into steam. Notice that this is already at high pressure. All we're doing is changing the volume. So now we have high pressure steam at the end of the exchanger, which goes into the steam engine. This is the expander, and its job is to expand from high pressure steam to low pressure steam. And the purpose there is for us to take work off that engine. Once we have low pressure steam, it goes to the cold exchanger where it's going to condense into water. And this is where we started. We have low pressure water, which is going to feed back through the water pump. And that's the cycle. These are the four components to the closed steam loop. The steam loop is represented by the four red arrows. Each arrow is actually a tube connecting a component to the next. It's important to know what is flowing through each tube. Here we have a line. Everything above the line is hot. Everything below the line is cold. Everything to the right of this line is low pressure. Everything to the left of this line is high pressure. We start at low pressure water. It turns into high pressure water, which turns into high pressure steam. There we go. And this becomes low pressure steam. And then we go back to low pressure water. So you should be aware that this is low pressure water. This is high pressure water. This is high pressure steam. And this is low pressure steam. Okay, the open system has two components, the boiler and the expander. This is characterized as energy deficit. The closed steam loop has four components. You should be able to list them off. If not, go back and memorize it, turn it into a jingle so that you can show those in order. The importance of the closed loop over an open system is that not only are we capturing and taking work off of the expansion, but we're also taking work off of the contraction. So this doubles our energy. This is important. This is important. But even at times two energy, we're still energy deficit. So the reason that you're still watching this video is so that you can learn about the fifth component, which opens up energy abundance. This is your introduction to the fifth component. It is the heat exchanger. We have a hot exchanger, a cold exchanger, and now we have the heat exchanger. Its purpose is to recycle heat. The way it does that is that it is a tube-in-tube counterflow exchanger, the critical thing being counterflow. Same direction, mixes are hot and cold into ambient. It destroys the potentials. Counterflow preserves our potentials, and it does it nearly to 100%. It's really quite amazing. It's magical. So there's not many things in life that are 100%, and this is one of them. But what's so cool about this is that there's no moving parts. It's a very simple device. It has a tube inside of a tube, and they're flowing in different directions. And the dynamic of it works, and it preserves the potentials and to nearly 100%, which means that we are recycling, we're recycling to 100% of wasted heat. This is the first part of the heat exchanger. And so I want to introduce that and get familiar with these dynamics. We have introduced the first dynamic of the heat exchanger, and that is that it recycles heat. Because of this dynamic, we have two flows. We have counterflow, and inside each flow, we can add thermal mesh. This is the second dynamic. You can't get this dynamic unless you know and understand and have created counterflow. Only then can you put thermal mesh into it. Why is this important? This is critically important, and the reason why is because that thermal mesh is internal energy. This is recognized in your physics books as the symbol epsilon. This is critically important because it is thermal energy storage. This is energy. It's in a stored form. It doesn't mean that we can't use it. I'm going to show you how to use it. And because it is thermal energy storage, and when we use it, taking it through a whole new door. The advantages of using internal energy to pay down some very expensive costs is revolutionary. And it's all about understanding and getting to the second dynamic. This is what is going to allow us to reach efficiencies, but beyond that, to reach outputs that are unprecedented. And it's only by using thermal energy storage.